I'm going to be facilitating and leading this time. This has always been one of the highlights and one of the unique features of the renewal, this opportunity we have to discuss the renewal topic, and that's what we are going to discuss during this time. We're going to discuss the overarching topic of the renewal. I do have some structure to provide for this discussion, but remember what our topic is. It's the centrality of the gospel, and that's what we're going to be discussing during this time. Now, when something is central, let's talk about what that means. What do we mean when we say the gospel is central? Well, something that is central is the essence of the thing. Something that is central is, that's what defines the thing. Okay, so when we say that the gospel is central, central to what? Central to the faith, central to Christianity, central to what it means to be a Christian, central to the church, central to the meaning of the entire biblical revelation. That's what we mean when we say the gospel is central. This is what defines the whole thing. So in other words, the gospel is not one of many subjects in the Bible that we can discuss. Really, the gospel is the subject of the Bible. And of course, there are other subjects, but they all fit under that subject. It's kind of like a mega narrative, if you will. The big story in the Bible, and by story I don't mean like a fairy tale story. It's a story that's true, that really happened, and that's happening, and things that will happen in the future. But that's the big story of Scripture. It's God's story, the gospel. That's what we're going to be talking about. That's what we're talking about this week. That's what we're going to be talking and discussing together in during this time. Now, when we talk about the gospel, what is that? Well, there's many ways that we can define the gospel, because the gospel has many different facets to it. It's sort of like a gem with many different cuts on the gem. And when you shine a gem that's been expertly cut in the light, it refracts the light, and there's all these different shining features that it does. That's kind of what we can do with the gospel. We can kind of hold it up like a gem, and we can look at its different facets and shine it in the light, and it shows us different aspects of God and of salvation. This is a big subject. This is not a small subject at all. That's why we spent the last 27 years unpacking this thing in these renewal meetings. So what is the gospel? Well, the word gospel simply means good news. The gospel is a report. It's news. It's the report of something that has happened, or something that has been done, or something that has been accomplished. That's what the gospel is. It's a message. The gospel is something that is preached or declared or proclaimed or taught or communicated. It has to be. The gospel is not just an idea that we're just to sit around and think about by ourselves. It's something that's to be shared, that's to be communicated. So it's a message primarily, and it's a message from God. It's a message about God. It's a message about what God has done to save the world through Jesus Christ. It's a message about what has happened in the past and has already been accomplished. It's a promise about what God will do for us today if we believe the message. And it's also a report about the future and things that are going to happen, that are going to be accomplished in the future, things that God has made commitments to do, promises that God has made for the future of the entire human race, actually. So it's a big deal. That's what we're going to be discussing. I'm going to guide us through this discussion with three different passages of Scripture that speak to the centrality of the gospel. I've chosen a verse from Romans that you've already heard a sermon on. I've chosen a verse from 1 Corinthians, and I've chosen a verse from Galatians to help us, to help kind of provide some structure and guidance for our discussion. Now, just a little bit of background on those texts. The book of Romans, of course, is probably the most important exposition of the gospel that we have in the entire Bible. I'm not the only one that has said that. There have been other men of God who have studied scriptures who have said that. The book of Romans is pivotal. It is an exposition of the gospel that Paul wrote to the church of Rome. And it's the other two passages are a little different from Romans. Romans is a heavy doctrinal book. When you go to Corinthians, 1 Corinthians in particular, and then to Galatians, the reason why Paul wrote to the church at Corinth and to the church at Galatia was a little different than why he wrote to the church at Rome. I don't really see that Paul wrote to the church at Rome to correct them. I think he was simply writing to lay out his message for them and say, this is what I preach. Because he'd never been there before. Now, when you get to Corinthians and Galatians, Paul has a different tone because it's a different reason for the writing. When we get to 1 Corinthians, Paul is correcting the church because there were several problems, but there was one particular thing that they had done. There was an aspect of the gospel that I don't know if it was all of them or a large portion of them, but there were people in the church at Corinth that flat out did not believe one of the major aspects of the gospel. And in the 15th chapter, Paul takes them to task and lays out for them this particular aspect of the gospel, and we'll talk about what that is. And we've already had, I think, a couple sermons on the book of Galatians. The Galatians had turned away from the gospel and had gone back into legalism. And Paul writes to correct them and to retrieve them from that very dangerous path that they were on. So I just want to give you a little bit of introduction to those letters. Keep those things in mind as we read these passages that we're going to discuss together. Here's what I kind of have in mind. We're going to write a sermon together, okay? I'm providing the outline, and the discussion is going to fill in the sermon, okay? So what is a sermon? Well, when we hear a sermon, we're listening to one person give what the Lord has given to them. So you're getting it through that one individual at a time. What we're going to do now is we're all going to chime in together and write a sermon together on the centrality of the gospel. We're all going to pool our resources and our thoughts. It's going to be kind of like playing in a symphony. We're going to get our instruments out together. We're going to play together. Hopefully it's all going to harmonize and not clash. Or it's like we're going to weave a tapestry together. And the end result, hopefully, will be something very beautiful. That's what is beautiful about the body of Christ, is that we can all contribute something that we would probably never get on our own. Now, because this is a discussion, I feel that I do have to provide some guidance and some structure, and I don't want to be a legalist, but I do feel compelled to lay down some rules for our discussion. And these are just so that things don't go off in strange directions. And there actually happens, I didn't plan this, there actually happens to be 10. That just happened that way. It was not planned, but there are 10 of these, okay? So here are the guidelines, the rules for our discussion. We ask that everyone come forward to the microphone to speak. Do not just shout from your seat. We are being recorded, remember, and we all want to hear you. That's why we have a mic up front. By the way, if you come up to speak, don't do this with the microphone, okay? Don't touch it. The microphone is holy. Do not touch it. Just talk into it, and you'll be fine, okay? Brother Bob wanted me to stress that the microphone should not be touched, okay? You might be noticing, there's no podium up there. He's breaking renewal tradition. There's always a podium up front for the discussion. Why isn't there a podium up front? Here's why. I don't want you to bring notes up here and read from notes. This is not a lectureship. I'm being a hypocrite and I have notes, but I'm the leader and I can do pretty much whatever I want. But I don't want you to bring, you can bring your Bible. If you want to bring your Bible, I'm not going to tell you not to bring the Word of God up here, okay? But don't get crafty and hide notes in your Bible. Because I'm going to be sitting right there, and I'll see everything that you do. Speaking of this chair over here, I'm going to be sitting in the chair. Here's what I want you to do, just so that we can have a little more order and facilitate the taping and the camera and everything. If there's someone speaking at the podium, and we want to form a line behind this chair, so wherever you're sitting, you're going to have to get up and come down either this aisle or the far aisle, and you just form a line to speak right there behind the chair while I'll be sitting, okay? When you make your comment, please address the question being considered and stay on target. You can go back and address previous questions if you want, but do not go on rabbit trails, personal thoughts, testimonies, rehearsing previous sermons, telling everybody how much you love me. You know, that's wonderful, but I don't need to hear it right now or anybody praise for anybody else. That's not why we're here. This is not open mic. Number three, make your comments brief as there are others who want to participate. Give ground to someone who has not spoken. If you have already been at the podium, I know some of you will jump up here 5, 6, 7 times if we give you the chance, you know. But if you've already been up here a couple of times or somebody else that hasn't been up, give ground. Younger people, give ground to the more mature people. Number four, if someone says something that is unclear or appears to be incorrect, we ask that any correction be made gently and kindly, always assuming the best. If someone says something that's a little weird, don't just assume they're a child of the devil. They're probably not. They probably just said something a little, you know, that wasn't clear. I will also assume that any person endeavoring to do correction will be one of the mature people here and not one of the younger and inexperienced people. If Brother Al wants to get up and correct something that is said, we'll submit what Brother Al has to say. If one of you teenagers gets up here and you're going to correct something, I'm probably not going to really be very happy about that. But don't be overly critical. If something really needs to be corrected, then yes. But let's not be nitpicky and, well, you just didn't say it exactly right. If you had added this word first, let's not be like that. If there is a disagreement or misunderstanding, please, we ask for more light and less heat. Okay? And don't take anything personally. If you get up, we've all had this experience with Brother Given, you know, you get up and you say something, Brother Given says, now, wait a minute, you know. Now, Brother Given isn't here, but, you know, if that happens, just you know, take your licks. If that happens to be you, it says something a little that somebody else says, I don't think that's quite right. Just take your licks. Don't take it personally. I've already said this. You should not need to bring notes. This is a discussion. Number six, please form the line. I already addressed that. Number seven, when you're up here, please speak clearly and loud enough to be heard. You know, you don't whisper. We want to be able to hear you. Number eight, this is my favorite rule. Please respect the discussion leader and allow him to lead. Do not attempt a hijacking. Number nine, remember to do everything decently and in order and unto edification. And finally, number 10, think carefully about your comment. I don't want to intimidate anyone from getting up here, but please think about what you're going to say. If it's not clear in your mind, it's probably not going to be clear in our minds either. Now, I have three passages, as I've said, to guide us. One from Romans, one from 1 Corinthians, and one from Galatians. And we're going to consider these passages under the following headings, okay? First, the gospel is central because it is divine power. Secondly, the gospel is central because it is foundational fact. And thirdly, the gospel is central because it is indispensable truth. So we're going to start with this point. The gospel, and we've already had this ministered to us, the gospel is central because it is divine power. And here's, of course, what Paul said in the book of Romans, Romans chapter 1, verses 16 and 17. For I am not ashamed of the gospel, for it is the power of God for salvation to everyone who believes, to the Jew first and also to the Greek. For in it, the righteousness of God is revealed from faith to faith, as it is written, but the righteous man shall live by faith. So that's our starting point. And here's where I want us to start thinking about this. And what I'm going to do here, I'm going to throw out several questions. If we don't have all of them answered, that's okay. But I'm going to throw out several questions and hope that something sticks, that someone will want to, you know, sort of get the juices flowing here. The gospel is divine power. So let's start by thinking about this subheading, the uniqueness of the gospel. The gospel is absolutely unique. There's nothing else like it. So with that in mind, let's consider some of these questions together. What other religious messages are out there, and how is the gospel different? What are some of the things the gospel can do that nothing else, no other message, no other emphasis can do? If the gospel is so special and so unique, why would anyone ever be ashamed of it? Paul said, I'm not ashamed of it. Well, why would anyone be ashamed of it? So those are my questions I'm throwing out. Let me restate them again. What the gospel is unique. What other religious messages are out there, and how is the gospel different? What are some of the things the gospel can do that nothing else, no other message or emphasis can do? And if the gospel is so special, then why would anyone be ashamed of it? Anyone want to get us started? Did any of those things stir up any thoughts? Go ahead, Jeff. Come on up.
All right, I'm so thankful to address the question. What's unique? Well, as you know, Brother Benoit's in India. There are 800 million Hindus over there. They have over 600 million gods and goddesses. And as I look at their religion, for example, which is not really easily categorized, it does not address a need for man to have virtue. And matter of fact, when I look at the Greek, you know, the Greek religions, which some think that the Hindu faith is an echo or an adoption of some of the Greek belief, because the Greeks actually reached India through Alexander the Great. And I've read an entire long book how northern India reflected Greek culture. And I look at Greek religion, which was present in Paul's day, the gods and goddesses and their religion had no virtue. The demigods that were produced through immoral relationships. And when you go to India, you'll see the goddesses and gods again. There's no virtue. It doesn't address the moral needs of the morality of man. Good and evil are not really addressed by these gods. Only power, ability to exemplify power. And there's a great warfare. I think that's a demonic element, that the demons don't get along maybe as well as we think. They are not. C.S. Lewis wrote about that in Screwtape Letters. So the gospel, though, has the power from God to actually make a man morally virtuous. Amen. In an incredible way. See, that's what people are rebelling against in modern culture, is the virtue attached to our faith, which one man, one woman for life seems impossible to the average modern day person now. It's mocked at. And yet, the gospel we have gives worldwide, no matter how depraved, you know, how lowly the culture has gone, as we see in Romans chapter 1, the fall of man into homosexuality and so forth, the gospel that we cherish and we share is power of God unto salvation that delivers a man not just cosmically or in some just covenantal way, but an actual change of the virtue or the morality. The goodness of God is given to man to participate in that. And that's something so unique about our gospel.
Amen. Amen. Now, what immediately came to my mind was something similar to what Brother Jeff was saying, is that all these other religions, that men have a sense within themselves that something is not quite right, that man is missing something. Some of the more tribal religions and things like that, it's evident to them that man doesn't have power. They don't have power over nature. They don't have power over those things. Some religions, like the Buddhists, you know, they more focus more internally. There's something in man that's missing. There's this realization as a result of the fall, that something is missing in man. The unique thing about the gospel is that it's actually able to address the nature of man. It's not merely just seeing a need to be virtuous but it's actually able to change who you are. That's the uniqueness of the gospel.
The gospel is the power of God unto salvation. It's power, and picking up where Brother Jeff left over, this is power that actually makes for satisfaction. Satisfaction meaning fulfillment. Maybe using this, remember Jesus said, he said, out of his belly shall flow rivers of living water. Remember, he that... trying to think of the first part there, John. He that, what's the, help me there with the first part of that one. he said, "He that heareth, he that keepeth my saying." No, that I'm connected. But anyway, this matter, this satisfaction, the satisfaction. See, it's not a satisfaction that makes for like fleshly fulfillment, but actually satisfaction that makes you sense that the fulfillment that you have is what you've actually been created for, what you've been made for in the image of God. That satisfaction, see, and that's a testimony to the uniqueness of the gospel.
You know, I was thinking about the facet of the uniqueness of the gospel, and that it allows what we call conversion. But conversion can't happen unless God is a part of that, and that's where the Holy Spirit comes from. Have you ever thought of the fact that the major religions that purport, you know, we have it figured out, are powerless? And that's the reason why they fail. You know, you think of the common individual involved in the religious realm. Why do they struggle? Why do they fall? Why do they just, it's an up and down situation because they don't have any power. And so we're equipped because what God has given us in the sumless of this gospel not only brings us to a point where we're yielding, we're buried, we're raised, but we walk in newness of life. But in that newness of life, we're taken care of because we can prosper because God is doing His good will in us through His power. So I think it's a unique part that God empowers us by the fact He gives us that through the Holy Spirit.
The gospel is powerful and has more power than the wicked one. And that is very, very important because there are so many religions who worship demons and idols that are controlled by demons, and they are enslaved by them. They live in fear and torment of them. And the gospel preaches a Jesus Christ that is bigger than a demon. He's bigger than the devil, and he's more powerful than the devil. And hey, he can set you free.
The gospel teaches us that our God is pleased with us. He's happy with us. There is no other religion that their God is happy with them. That's the difference. There's no other religion. I'm presently talking to somebody who does not believe in Jesus Christ as their Lord and Savior. And when I ask him, well, what are you going to do when you stand before a God that's not pleased with you? Because he knows he's not perfect. He knows he has flaws. He has no answer. But I have an answer. The gospel is Jesus Christ died for our sins. And because of him, our God is pleased with us. Satan, he is the accuser. He'll be the first one to make you question, well, am I really pleasing to God? The gospel will give you confidence. Yes, you are. You can live your life without wondering, within fear. You don't have to be fear anymore. You can live, see, in Christ Jesus, we can live a powerful life as overcomers. Victorious. We are victorious. Now we are seated with Christ in heavenly places. We are kings and priests. Now, see, today the religions, they don't teach that. They teach that you got to do what you can do now, but you never, ever, ever feel that you're adequate. No, if they're all, every one of them are honest, they're not adequate. But Christ was and is adequate. And he is going to be there with us when we stand before on the judgment day. He's going to be there with us. Without him, we know we have no hope. And we have nothing but fear. But with Christ, we have this confidence and blessed assurance that we're pleasing to our God.
In answer to your question of what is unique about the gospel, I thought the gospel convicts, and it either drives people to God or it drives them away from him.
In my work, I'm exposed to so many people that don't know Christ. And I'll tell you, they talk about God all the time. And I just want you to know, when they talk about God, they're not talking about our beloved, our great God of heaven, the Jehovah God. They're not talking about that God. They're talking about a God of their own idea. a God that doesn't have a gospel. Well, if they have a gospel, it's another gospel, that if I or an angel from heaven should come and teach you, preach you any other gospel, let them be anathema. That's the kind of gospel that they have, another gospel. And they're constantly talking about, we are God. God is here. We are God. And everything we need is inside of ourselves. That is the most empty, and that's what a majority of the world believes right now. That is the most empty, empty gospel. The difference is, the big unique thing for me is the gospel saves. I mean, the gospel saves. And I was thinking, too, I have a friend. She's transgender. That's what she calls herself. So when I first met her, she was an atheist, and now she at least believes that the world was created. And I mean, she's moving, so I hope that my words are making a difference. She wrote the other day about a family that had sold everything they had to go be missionaries in Japan, and they were just killed. The mom, the dad, and the two tiny little ones were killed in a car accident, and they burned. And she said, some Christians, please explain this to me. You know what? It's almost impossible to explain the hope that we have in Christ to someone that doesn't believe in Christ. That's the gospel. The gospel brings us hope. There is hope beyond, and peace that passes understanding, beyond anything that someone with a mind outside of Christ could even conceive or imagine. The assurance that that we realize this is just so temporary. This is just so, and if we died early, so to speak, like this family she feels did, what a great reward that we have, this guarantee, this assurance of heaven. That's all these things the gospel gives. The world has nothing to offer. This gospel saves. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish but have eternal life. And we get the treasure of that even here now in our earthen vessels, and we have the hope of, and the assurance of it in heaven. So we have so much to offer, but when the world says, when they're talking about God, they don't connect this true gospel that we have with the God they speak of. But we know in whom we have believed, and we believe, and we know that he's faithful to keep that which we've committed unto him against that day.
Yeah, a gospel that's not expressed is not effective. Paul said that through the foolishness of preaching, right? This gospel, it's as it's preached, it's as it's expressed, as it proclaimed. That's the power of God. I mean, now, the gospel, this good news of what Jesus, what good is it if nobody ever hears about it? Now, we have a lot of gospels being spoken out. A lot of, you turn on the radio, turn on the television, you get all kinds of different versions of what they call the gospel. But it's not this core message of what you just heard about, what God did in Christ. That's got to be preached. That's got to be proclaimed. And when it is, it changes someone. Someone's already said from the pulpit, if you're faithful to preach what God gave you in Christ Jesus, it will do something. It will have an effect. It may not be on the salvation for everyone. Someone may reject it, but it still had an effect, didn't it? So this gospel is powerful. And if it's alive in you, well, see, no one, if it's alive in you and you're walking by faith, you really don't need to be told to preach the gospel. I mean, this is something that, well, it'll come out. It'll come out in the least likely places, but it'll come out because it's in you. It'll come out of you.
Now, the scripture says that the message of the cross is foolishness. It's foolishness to those who are perishing. It says that it's foolishness to the Gentiles. You know, there's preaching the gospel, preaching Christ crucified is at variance with the world. Every other religion can be preached and be accepted by the world, by a worldview. When I was in the world, there was one point in time when I dabbled in other religions, Buddhism, and I had the same set of friends. They accepted me for being a Buddhist. There were, and this happens all the time when somebody would say, I believe this or I believe this, but the second somebody stands up and says, I believe the Lord, and they start preaching the gospel, it produces a different reaction. It produces a different reaction than any other religion. And the same, see, it pleased God by the foolishness of preaching to save those. So that's how the gospel difference is, that it's foolishness in the ears of those who are perishing, but to us who are saved, it's the power of God unto salvation.
Hey, this is a first for me. You know, we've been here talking for 2 days about how powerful the scripture is, how powerful the gospel is. And my question is, if this gospel is as powerful as we're saying, then why don't we realize how fragile evil really is? Because we've got this power in our hands, in our heart, in our souls, in our minds, every aspect of us. And yet, we still worry about evil. And I am convicted that evil will not touch me. I can rebuke it a million times a day because I have that gospel. I have that power. I am stronger than anybody I'll meet out on that street today. And I don't even have to lift weights. And I'm thinking that evil is only as strong as you will feed it. If you don't feed a fire wood, it isn't going to burn. It's going to go down into coal and then turn cold. There won't be any cinders. So if you're feeding evil in any way, shape, or manner, that's where it gets its strength from. But we have more power than most people we meet. And we have that power to stand up and say, Jesus is Lord. A woman was being robbed, and there was an assault that was happening to her as well. And she said, in the name of Jesus, don't do this. The perpetrator of this whole thing could not continue, could not even move, fell on the floor, and that was all she wrote. It could not move because of the power of the gospel. In Jesus' name.
What makes the gospel unique compared to everything else? The gospel is a testimony of how not only God planned salvation since the creation of life and the earth itself, but also that God is righteously merciful. You know, we live in a world where either it's culture or other religions that they base everything on a fate. Like, oh, well, that's a fate you deserved, or that's something that you've earned, almost like a legalistic mentality. You know, oh, well, you stole from somebody. Well, that means I have to chop off your hand, or et cetera, et cetera. What makes our God and the gospel different is that when the world deems that you deserve to have stones cast at you, God is busy casting the stones out of your heart and making you new. So,
on the question about the gospel being unique, with this gospel, we can have a relationship with God. It's not like we're just trying to make him happy so we won't go to hell. I mean, that's what we want to do, but we can have a relationship with him.
I am. With the gospel, every other religion can only rise as high as the one who created that religion, which means every other religion is, it can only rise as high as the ones that are trying to escape whatever they created the religion for. They want salvation. Well, how do you save yourself when you're the one that needs saving? And it always comes back to some system of law. If you do this, if you adhere to that, if you comply with this, if you do this feat or that feat, doesn't make any difference. It all boils down to you got to do something. I mean, even Eastern mysticism, you've got to empty your mind and be part of the great nothingness. You know, it sounds silly, but that's really what it teaches. With the Buddhists, you have to you have to empty yourself of self, and you have to respect all other life, all the little bugs and the trees. And if you're a pantheist, you're actually going down from mankind, but it still is the result of how you treat nature and how you respect other things. It's all what we do. They're seeking for a peace that they can't even define. There's just a hollowness in the soul of man that we need to the knowledge of God and faith in what he did to fill. And nothing else is really going to satisfy. If it could, there would be peace on earth. There would be equity among men. The ravages of sin would not continually present themselves among the people of the earth. But as long as we've got hatred and variance and strife and wars, rumors of wars, all of these plagues, if you will, they're like moral plagues on the human race, we know that we haven't attained to what we're seeking. We haven't found the right answer. We haven't corrected anything in ourselves or in others. So the gospel comes along, and instead of saying, all right, you're in a bad state, but now if you do this and this and this, then you can come out of this thing. There's a religion that has they're saying kind of as we are, God once was. As God is, we may become. And they use a lot of Christian jargon. And they're teaching that who we call God was once a human being just like us on some other planet, and that he attained to godhood, and that now he's populating this world and all of us can attain to godhood also. See, it's so convoluted. It's such a doctrine of devils. The ones that are the most dangerous are the ones that come along and hijack the language of Scripture and then twist it, make it just a little bit different. Somebody referenced this earlier. Satan added the word not to what God had said, and it changed everything. But the gospel has a witness in itself to those that believe it. Whether anybody else believes it or not, when we have believed, we know in ourselves we are not what we were, and that we didn't make that change happen. That the God of truth has worked in us and is continuing to, he has recreated us. He has made us a new creature so that we can say, like Augustine said, whenever someone from his past came along and trying to get his attention, he was ignoring her. And she says, Augustine, it's me. And he looked at her and he says, but it's not I. You're not talking to the same person. And so this is what the power is. We talk about power. This is the power of godliness and righteousness, what God has put in us and works in us, the power not only to just be in proximity to God, but to be joined to the Lord in one spirit. And we may look powerless in some ways. Everything doesn't always turn out the same, and it's not because the person doesn't have faith. But our hope is higher. Our hope is not fixed in this world. So Paul, good things happen, bad things happen, as men would count good and bad things. But in all things, he was more than a conqueror. His faith never failed. His reward was sure. And his words and his works were found to be true.
Amen. Brethren, Paul said, I'm not ashamed. And you might ask, or the questions ask, why would someone perhaps have to say, I'm not ashamed? And the gospel was engineered or designed by the Lord to eliminate sunshine soldiers, to eliminate the half-hearted, the non-committed. In John 6, you see Jesus deliberately teaching of such a intense type of lesson that they walk away until Peter said, until he says, you want to leave too? And Peter says, who else has the words of eternal life? And then Jesus says, the Spirit gives life, but the flesh profits nothing. The gospel is designed to eliminate the fleshly nature of man, and the cross is what I want to get to for a minute. The cross was a Roman executioner tool, and it was gruesome, and it was fearsome, and it was designed to be a terror instrument to actually use by the Romans. That's why when the cross is predicted in Psalm 22 and in Isaiah 53 and Zechariah 12:10, it's incredible because the Romans really used that. There were a few others that kind of used a bit, but to have the cross being used as an instrument of torture in the time of Christ was another divine thing that he had brought into being so that Christ would be crucified. It should have been stoned by the Jews because stoning is what they did for blasphemers. But the way God turned that the Romans actually did the execution of Christ is amazing. And see, Pilate was a Roman governor. And the thing was done under his auspices, even though he washed his hands. In other words, from the time the Savior was crucified, Christianity was an illegal religion. It was not a religio lectitia, or however you say that in the Latin. It was illegal. Now, living in Africa, I can tell you that at times, if you're not careful, you can be frightened by government. You don't want to go. I was willing to go to a jail or a prison in Ghana, and the ambassador said, do not go. So the early church faced continual fear barrier, you might call it, of the Roman government. It was not a state-approved religion at all. And it was kind of under the radar for a while there, and the Jews were actually worse opponents. But then, by Domitian's time and Nero's time, Nero took men and impaled them on poles. If you read about it, it's horrendous, and lit them on fire. There was a need to be brave. And the man who surrendered to God needs to continue to surrender. If our Lord said, not my will, but your will be done, remove this from me in Gethsemane, though I think it's more than the physical pain and so forth. It was a separation from our Lord, from our Father. But that's something that I think Paul had to adopt that mindset, that conviction, and speak it. I am not ashamed. I am not. And he went through, as preaching something that any Roman could have picked up and said, who killed your Messiah? Roman? Oh, who was in power? Everywhere he went. Everywhere he went. And I don't, I once had a soldier tell me, they crucified your Lord, they could crucify you. It's kind of scary words to hear, things like that. So that was the one thing. The other thing was that in the Jewish faith, anyone who was hung on a tree was considered cursed. And so that's why in 1 Corinthians, probably I'm getting ahead of myself, but of what we're going to, but I would just beseech everyone here that we need to prepare our mind to be brave. A time could come, and is already there for some brethren, where it will be illegal to have this meeting. That every word we would speak to anyone else about Christ would be illegal, with a great penalty attached by the state. But like Paul, we can be able to be brave, because it's a light and momentary affliction as compared to the weight of the glory that we'll be inheriting. And that will make us really consider heavenly things and take them to heart.
One of the many unique things about the gospel is that it draws. It draws because men, whenever they see it, they want it and they like it and they want to know more about it. And from what I know, which isn't too much, but other religions, it's more of people are scared into believing them because they're fearful about what will happen to them if they don't believe. But the reason we're here and the reason we believe in the gospel is because we're anticipating the things that will happen.
I think Brother Silas kind of might have said a lot of what I wanted to say. And I stand corrected here. I'm not an expert on this, but my impression is that a lot of religions, as Sister June had said, they ask the disciple to clear their minds. They're operating on your mind. And if it's not that kind of religion, it's a religion where there's many gods and you have to appease them so that you can do better in the world. Stronger, more money, faster, and so on. Our God works on the heart. From the heart, then we get what's in our head and our behavior. So we have a God that draws us to Him. We don't go seeking that God. And once He's drawn us, you know, the good news is now I can give you a new heart. I'm not going to give you a stronger arms or a bigger bank account. I'm not asking you to empty your mind and dream of an afterlife or some kind of, what's the word that's used when you come back as a bug? Right, I'm not asking you to, you know, to think about the reincarnation, which some religions do. So you've got a new heart, which no other religions are telling you about, and you've got an eternal life. It's not a different being like a reincarnation. You've got an eternal life that starts the day you get that new heart. So you walk through the rest of your earthly life, and when you leave this mortal coil, you got that life continuing in the presence of the Lord. So I think it's pretty unique.
Well, I guess I'm too short to reach the microphone. Thank you. I want to tell you about something I saw on YouTube. It really affected me. I was studying about why people go into some of these big churches, and they figured out that only 2% of the people came in because they people ministered to them about the gospel, and over 98% of those people, the other people, just came in because there's a lot of people and they had loud music, and then they interviewed this other little church, very little church, and all of them just came in because the gospel was just everything to them. And this church was in a different country. This one was in China. And all of them came in because of the gospel. And they got new Bibles. And I couldn't believe the reaction. It just awed me. They were kissing the Bibles. They were just holding them. They were crying. And the other people at that church should treat their Bibles like, oh, it's just a book. It's just a book of fairy tales. That really angers me, but we need to minister to them so that they'll treat their Bibles like they should, and that they could go to heaven and not just know if they're being part of a church and they do good things, they'll just go to heaven. That's not right. We should know that the gospel is the way to heaven.
Our gospel is unique because it teaches us a lot about the Father, and it's also unique because it has a lot of power. Also, we need to disconnect from this world to have the gospel.
The reason the gospel is so unique is because you can't get it anywhere else but through the one true God.
I've been thinking about this a little bit and kind of go along with what Sister June said. The rest of the religions, of what I understand, is man-based. Do this, and thou shalt die. Do this, and thou shalt live. Whatever it is. The gospel, the uniqueness of the gospel is it glorifies God. Every other religion glorifies man in some form. Either look what I have done, I have done this and this and this and this. I fast 2-3 times a week. I tithe. But the gospel glorifies God. Or the other religions of the world glorifies a man. How can this be? How can you attain anything higher than what this earth has to offer if you are worshiping something that is created in this earth? The gospel elevates us higher than that. The gospel points us to the one who gave us the gospel. It points us to the one who gave us eternal life. And through the gospel we understand, and through the gospel and through the law we understand that we cannot attain this apart from God, because the flesh is weak. So we see that that's one of the big uniquenesses of the gospel, is it glorifies God. He's the one that gives it. He's the one that orchestrates it. And we just have to live in it by the grace that He gives us.
The gospel is unique because we have as a Savior a person who is both God and man.
So I was just thinking about the problem of guilt. And I've seen, especially this summer, I've seen lots of people try and deal with guilt. And you see the people of the world, their answer to guilt is, it's okay, smile. And it makes me sad how the people in the world see somebody who's broken, see somebody who realizes that they've sinned and they know something's wrong, and the only answer they're fed is feel happy. And it's very sad, but the good news of the gospel is that we have something to say to people who are guilty. We have something to offer. We have Jesus Christ has made it so that our guilt can be cleared. So we don't have to just ignore our guilt, but Jesus has actually provided an answer for our guilt. And He's provided a way that we can become not guilty, not just not think about it.
The gospel is the only message of the salvation of man that has a witness of truth, not only in it, but around it. You take away the gospel and you have really no logical explanation for the world, for creation, for man. You have no basis for sin or guilt or hope. There's nothing there. But we have a foundation upon which this message has been laid, so that we can know, we can see the evidences of a God of truth, who when He says something, everything lines up with it. Amen. Whenever He does something, we can recognize it because His word and what we can perceive, and He's put it here for that reason. He's given us these things to substantiate to those who would be seeking. Now, I'm not saying that we believe because we have a view of creation. But once we see what God has said, we see that what we're looking at matches that. We don't have to overlook reality in order to believe this message. These other messages, you have to turn a blind eye to reality in order to accept them. Now, humanism is a religion. In order to accept humanism, you have to believe. See, this is not science. You have to believe that no God created the heavens and the earth, that they are self-created somehow. And as far back as I'm aware that they can go is the Big Bang Theory, where all, and I've heard this numerous times, I am not making this up, all of the matter in the perceived universe and beyond what we can see was once about the size of a golf ball. And that finally it just got so hot it exploded. And then things began to coalesce, and one thing led to another, and chance and time. They're our creator. Well, no. You have to ignore physics. You have to ignore things that are clearly seen in order to believe that. These other religions, they cannot be proven. They cannot be tested. They don't have any intelligent being behind them that has given them a message that is clear and concise, and that we can say, I know that to be the truth. Jesus was the Son of God. He came and he dwelt here. Some of his best witnesses are the ones that hated him, and they wrote about him. Well, that means he was here, right? So what I'm saying is, it is the only message given to man where everything is consistent, and that the truth is perceptible, and that men have to either have an evil heart of unbelief to reject it, or they have to have faith to receive it. But whatever you have, nobody has what they have without being persuaded of something one way or the other. There is no such thing as a scientific religion. So, but this is the truth. So we have evidences in ourselves and externally, and it is consistent.
In the gospel, everything is of God. He's the beginning and the end, the Alpha and the Omega. And so God is the one that condemned. He concluded all under sin. And now God is the one who's saving. God's the one who made the pronouncement, the judgment of guilty. He's the one that provided the means to escape that guilty status. And he's the one that's going to receive the ones who were saved. Now, in contrast to that, in nature or in the court of men, the judge would most of the time be the third party. It would be the accused and the offended, and those two parties would then come to a third party that's removed from the situation. But God's the one that was sinned against, God's the one who provided a lamb, and God's the one who is receiving the sinner back to himself. And so he's literally in the ultimate sense, in the fullest sense, all things are of God.
Paul said, having therefore obtained help of God, I continue unto this day witnessing both to small and great, and saying none other things than those which the prophets and Moses did say should come, that Christ should suffer, and that he should be the first that should rise from the dead, and should show light unto the people and to the Gentiles. In the gospel, you have something that's been prophesied hundreds of years before, even thousands of years before. In the gospel, you have what the other religions don't. The other religions have their books, but they don't have a prophecy. How do you argue with Psalm 22 or Isaiah 53 or the picture of Abraham offering Isaac? There's a witness of prophecy to the gospel.
I was also thinking about this, what Paul said, I'm not ashamed. And another aspect of this is I'm not disappointed. And so when Paul heard the gospel for himself, he wasn't disappointed. He received it. He believed it. He was changed by it. And and so when he preached it, he wasn't ashamed, because he knew, like, what is he going to do? He's going to choose, am I going to preach the gospel? Or do I have something else? And, well, he wasn't ashamed of the gospel. He knew that is the power of God unto salvation. And that's also what's unique about the gospel, is the people who preach the gospel is different. It's much different than people who preach other gospels or other religions, because they have to be indoctrinated. The gospel actually changed the one who's preaching it. And that's what, so those who preach it, they know what the gospel can do. They know that it's the power of God because they have a firsthand experience. They've been changed by it, so they know if I preach this, you can be changed by it too.
In answer to the question of what is unique about the gospel, it makes sense more than any other gospel can make. Like evolution, it does not make sense, and neither does any other gospel.
The gospel is unique because it can get us from this earth to heaven.
Pardon me for my notes. I don't know if this will conclude it for you or not, but it does for me. Several of you have talked about this change and transformation that takes place in the one who believes the things that have been made known, this revelation from on high. Well, the Master himself talked about this, the agent of this change. When he has come, that is, the Comforter, John 16, when he has come, he will reprove or convict the world of sin, of righteousness, and of judgment. Of sin because they believe not on me. Of righteousness because I go to the Father and ye see me no more. Of judgment because the prince of this world is judged. Now this gospel message that has been preached to us and that we have believed and that we now preach, see, is based upon these things. The central issue, of course, is this man who came from God, not generated by human imagination, desires, by deifying something that we already are enslaved to or love or value or treasure. But it came from another place. And based upon him, we know about sin and righteousness and judgment. Based upon what he has said and done, we know these things. When this message is preached effectively and powerfully, then this power, this conviction, this reproof from God comes to the heart. It comes to the heart that's willing to receive it. Of course, some just reject it out of hand. Some may receive it for a while, but because of trouble, they let it go. Some may receive it for a while, but because of affluence and good things, they let it go. But the good and honest heart, that's how the Master described it there in Luke, the good and honest heart receives it implanted. And it bears fruit. Because of this power, this calculated power. And we see the power of God working in creation. We see it working in Egypt. We even saw it working in Jerusalem, didn't it, when the walls came down and the Babylonians came in. But this message declares to us that the power of God is calculated to transform and to save. That's what makes it unique. Not because of something we've generated ourselves, concocted ourselves, imagined ourselves, however you want to describe it, but because of what God has promised. Brother read that text there from Acts. The things that have been witnessed. It's, well, the words of the angel to Daniel sealed up vision and prophecy, didn't it? This gospel message seals that vision and prophecy. And it works in each of us who believed to transform us, to make us strong, to make us able to stand now, but moreover, to stand on that day. And there's no other message that will do that, none other.
We're going to shift to this second question. All the thoughts have been very good, but I do want to address some of these other things as well. In 1 Corinthians 15, we're going to look at this this thought for a few minutes here. The gospel is foundational fact. The gospel is central because it is foundational fact. Now, I made mention of the church at Corinth. The church at Corinth was a mess. You cannot imagine a more chaotic church. And one of the issues that Paul touches upon that may have been the most serious issue was the fact that there were some people there. I don't know how many. I don't know if it was the majority or minority or what. But Paul addresses that there were some people at Corinth who did not believe in the resurrection. Now, here's what Paul says when you come to the 15th chapter. Here's what he says. Now I make known to you, brethren, the gospel which I preached to you, which also you received, in which also you stand, by which also you are saved, if you hold fast the word which I preached to you, unless you believed in vain. For I delivered to you as of first importance what I also received, that Christ died for our sins according to the Scriptures, and that he was buried, and that he was raised on the third day according to the Scriptures, and that he appeared to Cephas and to the 12. After that, he appeared to more than 500 brethren at one time, most of whom remain until now, but some have fallen asleep. Then he appeared to James, then to all the apostles, and last of all, as to one untimely born, he appeared to me also. Notice here that Paul lays out some foundational facts about the gospel, things that have happened. So here are some questions for us to consider and to discuss a little further on this point. Why is it significant that the gospel is based on things that actually happened? Now, remember what Paul said. Christ died, he was buried, he was raised, he appeared. Those things are things that happened. Why is it significant that that's the gospel? What is the difference between a fact and an idea? Is the gospel more of a fact or an idea? And does this distinction matter? Why does it matter? What is the source of our facts about the gospel? Is this source trustworthy? How do we know we have not believed in a lie or in a myth? What would you say to someone who just said, well, Christianity is just a legend or some kind of a myth? I'll throw one more in here. Why is it essential that we believe in the facts of Christ's death, burial, and resurrection? Can a person be a Christian and reject those things? So I hope that stirred up a few thoughts here. Let me go through these again. Why is it significant that the gospel is based on things that actually happened? Christ died, buried, raised, appeared. What's the difference between a fact and an idea? Is the gospel more of a fact or an idea? Does that distinction matter? What's the source of our facts about the gospel? Is it trustworthy? How do we know we've not believed a lie or a myth? And why is it essential that we believe in the facts of Christ's death, burial, and resurrection? Can a person call himself a Christian and reject some or all of those things? That stir anything up? Anybody want to address that? Brother Al, go first, and then Brother Jeff will come to you.
I would prefer not to use the word fact because it has the meaning of something that's made. Made up, actually made, you know, fact is, the word fact actually means something that's made. I think a more proper word would be like a declaration of truth. The gospel is a declaration of truth. The death of Christ, the burial of Christ, and the resurrection of Christ are a declaration of absolute reality. Absolute reality. Substantive reality. Now, at the beginning, when people first hear about the gospel, they believe, you know, we're called upon to believe just these words of the Scripture. Yeah, that's the starting point. We believe we take the words of the Scripture and we get them inside of us. But the time has got to come when men live in this reality. These words have to become substantive reality. We've got to live in the doctrine. This is essential to believing the gospel. If the time has got to come when we actually live in the death of Christ and in his burial and in his resurrection. This is our life. All of these things are our life, and these are just like the foundation. These are foundational things upon which everything else related to the gospel is built upon. But this is the foundation and the core. Substantive reality. Declaration of truth.
The comments just made by Brother Al just are completely in line with what I want to add to. You know, the gospel is too good to be true to carnal man. That hit me once in New York. I was walking there, and there's so much ungodliness there. See, man has become used to himself as a sinner. And when you think of man, you think of failure. All history proves that. And even Alexander the Great, after he conquered the world, he died almost, at the young age of about 30. So man has a problem with himself, and that is he defines his reality by his own reckoning, by his own viewpoint. And that comes far short of the reality as God would define it. You know, if it's an idea, then why not have a celestial symposium of a sort, and then let the best, the idea kind of take place in that atmosphere of consideration, and then we've settled the whole issue of God's power, of his character, of his love, of who God is, because the gospel shows who God really is. It exposes to us the true nature of God. So it comes to a bigger question of why is there a physical reality, so to speak? Why the world created? Why are there stars? Why is there gravity? Why is there the earth? The physical things. God made them, and as 1 Corinthians will point out later, it's first the physical, then the spiritual. So God has decided that this is a huge set, like for a movie set, or for a play, and upon this, he's exposing spiritual truths of great import that will last for eternity. They're already true, but they're being brought in a very special, fantastic way and we're privileged to be the actors in that play to portray the glory of our God. So the physical resurrection of Jesus Christ is a leverage. It's a real event. And it's a leverage of God to use to take something that would be too good to be true in any physical, material way of looking at it, human way of looking at it, and bring us to understand that nothing's impossible for God. The worst thing can happen is death to us. And so Jesus kind of easily handles death, He even folds up his grave clothes and walks out, and he's done with that. He's never going to go through that again. It's a one-time event. So when people consider the resurrection as a true event, then it opens them to the physical resurrection of Jesus Christ. It opens them to the spiritual resurrection, to be seated with Christ and to eternal realities of sonship, of being glorified with him forever. But when you're talking to unbelievers, or when this fact of the resurrection comes across to them, if they choose to accept that, a true event of history, his story, then everything else opens up. When I was in Kosovo with a brother, Wes Dingman, he made it clear to me that when you're talking to Muslims, there's only one thing to get across, that Jesus rose from the dead. If that's accepted, you've won the battle. Everything else comes after that. So the resurrection of Jesus Christ is power applied to man to open himself up to all the great spiritual power and realities of heaven. And it's so important that we proclaim the resurrection, we believe the resurrection. And finally, I say that if that be true, then everything else is true, that we can overcome sin, bad culture, bad parenting, whatever would put us down. Once you believe Jesus rose from the dead, and you take that and you hold on to that, then you can rise up from anything else and finally be raised in the final day to be seated permanently with Christ as the Son of God. I hope that makes sense.
Remember, God said, heaven is my throne and earth is my footstool. The natural and the supernatural are not meant to contend, but rather God has always blended them together in our understanding. Like in 1 Corinthians, he talks about Adam. As in Adam, all die. So in Christ, all are made alive. So he's reasoning back and forth from the natural to the spiritual. The natural is just a small segment of the supernatural. It's just like a place, a segment, a niche. Time is a niche in eternity. And so God works back and forth. And also what this does is, if the real things are just like discarded and people take what they call things they believe, then they might consider them theoretical or they're not so valid.
Well, then how do you actually realize that one that believes actually has a changed life? See, these two things have to blend together. So a changed life, may start from the inside, but it does express itself in an outward way. So you reason from the outward in and then from the inward out.
Well, what you said, is it important that there are actual physical events that the gospel declares to which these truths are connected to? I think that there's something being accomplished in the demonstration of these things that could not be accomplished otherwise. It may not be a direct parallel, but I was thinking of even in the world of earthly science, you know, a theory is a theory until it's demonstrated, until it can be confirmed. And so in accomplishing these things, God is like putting himself and his nature on display, not only for us, but for the principalities and powers and heavenly places looking on. It's important that these things happened. And the other question, talking about how do we know that we have not embraced a lie? Well, it's the same in us. The reason why I know that I haven't been embraced alive is because these things have been demonstrated in me, in my life, and Christ living in me, I've actually experienced this change.
We know these things in the gospel are real because we have faith as evidence.
There is a heaven and there is a hell. And there was a reason for a Savior, because Jesus would not have come if there wasn't something to be saved from. And everlasting punishment and everlasting life go hand in hand. The fact of the gospel that was really powerful, because it's, you can reject the idea of God, but the idea that there is a hell that lasts forever and heaven or eternal life that lasts forever is pretty impacting. And what got me was the resurrection of Jesus Christ, because the resurrection of Jesus Christ is a fundamental fact of history that can be proved. I studied it because I wanted to throw the whole thing away. But you can't deny the resurrection of Jesus Christ. You get to it and there's no other way around it. It's a fact of history. It's there. It's in your face. He did rise from the dead, and it is proved by hundreds of witnesses, of documents that go back, and unlike what Time magazine wants to say, the Bible was written by the people that it said they were written by. And we can go down to the Dead Seals Groves and prove that that was the true case. And the whole history of our world is based on the church and Jesus Christ and the Christians and everything and all the reactions against them. All history is based on that. You can't deny it. It's there. It's in your face. It's a fact. And because Jesus came and died and came back from the grave, he proved that what he said was true. I am the first fruits of the resurrection. I was raised from the dead so you can be raised from the dead. I came to save you from eternal death, which is due for everyone who has sinned. He didn't die just for nothing. I mean, he wouldn't have come if there wasn't everlasting death and everlasting hell. And his resurrection and his death, burial, and resurrection proves that there is a heaven, there is a hell, and God loves us, and we can be sons of God.
You know, I find that find the question interesting, you know, how to, as far as empirical evidence and the fact that we try to deny, prove it to me. You know, when I drive around here in Missouri, I see on the license plate, show me. I often want to show me how to drive. But Paul addresses to the Romans in the first chapter. He says, for the wrath of God is revealed from heaven against all ungodliness and unrighteousness of men who suppress the truth in unrighteousness, because that which is known about God is where? Evident within them, he says. For God made it evident to them. For since the creation of the world, his invisible attributes, his eternal power and divine nature have been clearly seen, being understood through what has been made, so they are without excuse. So, You have to work on it to deny that God is evident within us. And that's what happens here. This is where these people got to a point where they worked on it so hard, and this is the result of a society going wrong. And you know, we're living in a society the same way. We've worked on it so hard and so long that now we've got people that don't even understand themselves. But the fact is that God has still made it evident to this. You know, several years ago, I was working with someone, and they said to me, he said, John, how do you know that there is life after death? You know, as he addressed also 1 Corinthians 15. And he said, as I held his hand, and he's going out into eternity, he says, how do I know what's on the other side? And as I said this to him, I said, you know, I've never been there and come back. But Jesus Christ broke the bonds of death so that we understand today, he says, that the power of the resurrection, I've established that in this example. And because I've resurrected from the dead, all these promises are true. Amen. And you know what? That's something that we can understand, because you and I are headed there. The only way you and I can prevent death is that you've got to hold your breath. Because you're a dying individual. Every breath you take, you're facing that final end. You know, it's within us. God is within us. It says it's evident to us. But if we work to suppress it, which we can, one day we'll see that wrath come. And then God is identified in how he proves it, because he says the wrath of God is revealed. So we understand that. So whether you ask of it, is it real or not, God says, yeah, I put it within you. And we can establish that.
So Jesus told his disciples to follow him, which means we can only do that which he has done, and we can only go where he has gone. And so if what he has given us is an idea of dying with him, then that's all we have. And if all he has given us is an idea of being buried with him, then it's up to us to figure out just what exactly that means. And if what he has given us is merely an idea of being risen with him, and Christ is not risen, then our faith is futile, and we are still in our sins. But if he truly did die, then we can also die with him. And if he was buried, then we are buried with him. And if he is risen, then we have hope, because we're going where he goes, and we are where he is.
I think we're supposed to stop at 5. Time has really flown by here. So is there anyone else that hadn't had a chance to get up here that wanted to say anything? Not if you've been up here 2 or 3 times. I'm asking if there's anyone that hasn't been up here that had something to say about what we've discussed. Anybody? Okay. Well, let me wrap up. We didn't get to our third point, but I want to say one more thing about what we were just discussing from 1 Corinthians chapter 15. And I want to conclude and touch a little bit on what I was going to talk about from the book of Galatians. But regarding this 1 Corinthians chapter 15, I didn't get to this question, but I think this is a point to throw out and to consider. As we go out into our culture today, there are what I would call roadblocks to the gospel in culture. Now, this is what actually had happened to the Corinthians. There, because of Greek philosophy, Greek philosophers rejected the importance of the physical body, and therefore they rejected the validity of someone rising from the dead. Why would you even want to be raised from the dead? That was the philosophy of the day. I just want to be released from this body. The idea of having a body or being raised was ridiculous to the Greeks. And so that may have been why there's some of the people at Corinth had such trouble with the resurrection. Now, that may not be the specific issue for us, but just think about the fact that when you go out to communicate the gospel, there are things like that in every culture where people will say, I can't believe the gospel because of this. Christians say Jesus is the only way. I say there is no such thing as absolute truth. Therefore, I can't believe the gospel Those kind of roadblocks are there in people's minds. And I don't want to go any further with that, just to throw it out and say, we will encounter those things. And of course, the weapons of our warfare are not carnal, but mighty through God for the throwing down of strongholds. There is a way to overcome these kind of roadblocks and obstacles in people's minds. It's just something that we need to consider and think about. Now, this final point here that we didn't get to at all from Galatians, I'll just want to conclude with this thought. You know, Paul said this to the Galatians, "I'm amazed that you are so quickly deserting him who called you by the grace of Christ for a different gospel, which is really not another, only there are some who are disturbing you and want to distort the gospel of Christ." And we've already heard this text, but even if we or an angel from heaven should preach to you a gospel contrary to what we have preached to you, he is to be accursed. As we have said before, so I say again now, if any man is preaching to you a gospel contrary to what you have received, he is to be accursed. And we need to understand, I think all of us do understand this, that we live in a time when there are, within the church now, I was talking about culture, our culture around us, now I'm talking about the church. What Paul's addressing here in Galatians are teachers that came into the church. These were not people, these were not Greek philosophers. That's not what he's dealing with in Galatians. There were people who came, who said Jesus was the Messiah. The Judaizers, they believed Jesus was the Messiah. They would have said, we're Christians. And they started adding to the gospel. And we're living in that kind of day. Circumcision isn't the issue today. But there are other issues. There are teachers within the church who are saying, the gospel is okay as far as it goes, but there's something else you need, and they tack something else on. That is happening all around us. It is possible for a person to start out with the gospel, to be a believer, and at some point along the way, to hear another message, to hear another teacher, and to desert that gospel. That's what they did in Galatia. That's exactly what Paul says. He says, you have fallen from grace. They started out good. They heard a false message. They deserted the gospel and turned to another teaching. It is imperative. This is why we say that the gospel is not just for non-Christians. The gospel needs to be preached in the church to Christians. This is the center of our message. And for one reason for that is to protect ourselves from deserting it, to protect ourselves from false gospels. And they're everywhere in this culture. And they're everywhere in the church, I should say, in this culture. So let us take some warning here, too, at the end of this. We're all here and we're glad to be here together, and we perhaps take a lot of things for granted that we know these things and we've got a firm handle on this thing. Let's not be overly confident. Let's be confident in God and in the gospel, but let's not be overly confident in ourselves. Let's remember it is possible if we do not guard ourselves to listen to the wrong thing, to get off track, to get away from the gospel to some other center. Remember, what's the theme? The centrality of the gospel. It is so easy to make something else the center. Even the church. Some people say it's the church is the center. No, the gospel is what is central. I want to thank all of you for your involvement and for this discussion. It went by so quickly because so many of you had good things to say, and we appreciate that. I think, we'll pray for dinner. That's our next event, so us bow in prayer, and we'll thank God for our food, and then in a few minutes we'll be ready to eat together. Our Father in heaven, we thank you for the gospel. And Father, may it always be clear in our minds. May we cling to it, not only intellectually, but in our hearts. May we hide these things in our hearts so that we may not sin against you. Father, I thank you for the body of Christ and the beauty of being able to share freely with one another the truth, to edify one another as we have done. We ask, Father, that this would continue as we eat together. And we thank you for the fellowship we have around around this food. We thank you for the provision of this food and that we have such an abundance provided for us. We ask your blessings upon the hands that have prepared this food for us. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen.